It's 7:30, it's BBC Two, it's Springwatch, and it's live. And over the last 24 hours, we've had lots of drama here, especially involving our great tits.
We'll be looking in detail at how the late spring has affected some of our migrating birds, like this gorgeous firecrest.
And we'll be exploring an old bomb site to find out about the fascinating wildlife that lives there. What is it? Tonight, it's a smorgasbord of wildlife. It's Springwatch!
Yes, welcome to Spring Watch, coming to you live from the RSPB's beautiful Ynysheer Reserve in Wales. What a spot it is. Look at this. You can see the Dovey Estuary on the right of your screen there, and this rich mosaic of habitats which lead up to us, somewhere nestled down in the valley amongst the woodland. And of course, all of that habitat means a great range of species. We've got many of them bugged with our cameras. We've got our nosy noses into lots of nests, and that promises lots of activity.
Indeed we have. We've got lots of different families, lots of different habitats. We've got our red starts. Here they are, inside the box, snuggled down, the little chicks there, looking nice and healthy. We've also got our meadow pipits. Now they're in a completely different area. There it is, down in the mire. Oh, there we go. Mum's in there feeding them. Could be mum, could be dad, can't tell the difference. Looking lovely.
But the big news happened last night, right at the end of our programme. And if you weren't watching, I'll give you a clue. It was with a great tit. So let's have a look live at their nest box. And it is empty, which means they all fledged. Now, it took us by surprise at the end of the programme because it all seemed to happen extremely quickly. Let's take a look. There's the parent bird coming into the nest box, having a little peek in. But if we go into the nest box, we can see five very healthy chicks. Now, they've been ready to go for a while. They've been flapping their wings, they've been stretching. We've been predicting since the weekend. Well, 8:54, one popped its little head out and flew off. Just 2 minutes later, the second one, 8:56, left the nest box. And they all really quickly followed. A minute later, at 8:57, out goes the third. Followed very quickly by the fourth at 8:58. There he is, flying up. Actually took a couple of goes, this one, but eventually pokes the little head out, off he goes. And this one seems to parachute down from the top of the nest box, flutters up, 9:03, just 9 minutes later, the fifth chick fledged. Now, as I say, it did take us by complete surprise because it's very unusual for it to happen that quickly. Even the parent bird pops its head back and is rather surprised to see them all gone. Also very unusual for them to go at that time of night because very vulnerable. We wanted to know where they'd gone, so we sent one of our camera team out. He didn't manage to see them in the evening, but he did get a glimpse of them in the morning. There's one of them looking very healthy. Now, they will be looked after by the parents for a few weeks after fledging, but they're very curious birds. You can see that chick's already having a good look round and probably starting to feed itself. There's another chick, there's the parent bird. Now, we don't know how many our cameraman saw. He thinks he saw 4 out of 5, obviously very difficult to tell them apart. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean the fifth one didn't make it. They are extremely difficult to spot. And as I say, we're really chuffed that we've managed to see them. They've got through the night and they're looking good. But we do think, if our memory serves us correctly, that that's a first for Springwatch, that we saw them fledge live on the programme. It was right at the end of the programme, mind you. And if you were watching last night, you'll know that we all got extremely excited.
And it was unusual, and that's why we've not seen it before, because they were going in the evening, as you've already said. They typically go out in the morning, which gives them the day to settle down. Now, if you were watching our programme last week, or indeed over the last couple of days, you'll know that some of the stars of our drama have been our jackdaws. One pair of them, with young, have been under relentless attack by another couple of jackdaws that are lower down the social order and want their nesting spot. We saw this morning. The attacks have continued. They've been causing quite a lot of distress for people, I have to say. And you can see why. These birds are intent on removing these youngsters. Thankfully, the youngsters are big enough to withstand these sorts of attacks, certainly for the moment. But they're not only intent on removing the youngsters, because what they want is that nesting space, they're intent on building their nest even if they've got rid of them or not. Look at this. They've even started to bring in nesting material whilst these jackdaws are still in there. Those youngsters are still in there, bringing in some sheep's wool, which they lined the cup of their nest with. And here, another one of the birds brings in some dung or some mud. And typically, they would use that as a foundation for that wool lining, making a cup out of this. So they're so keen to get in here. They do get caught out once in a while. One of them's been grabbed here by one of the chicks, adults in attendance. It's come back. And just listen to this. Been pinned down, and eventually, after a big rough and tumble, it gets pushed out. Ooh. And then the parents come back in. The young are hunkered down. They're a bit shocked, I should imagine, and they've been hiding from those intruders and their attack. And eventually the adults think, well, if you're not going to take the food, we'll have it ourselves. It can't go to waste. We've been out and foraged and found it. You see, life is wild. A lot of people have been very upset about these attacks. And one comment we've had is, if nest boxes are in such short supply, why don't you put up some more nest boxes? And then they might occupy one of the new ones and leave those chicks alone. Well, the first thing to say is there are a lot more nest boxes here anyway. But there will always be a shortage of nest for these birds. The other thing is that we don't interfere. It's not our policy. Life is wild out there. And whilst these things may look brutal and they may look savage, these are human emotions. You can't allow that sort of thing to happen. You've got to be pragmatic and you've got to be practical about it. Although, having said that, I did get a tweet last night saying, "Dear Chris Packham, would you be quite as pragmatic and dispassionate if a great white shark swam up and bit your leg off?" Well, yes, mate, I would. I'd be looking at the dentition, making sure that it was all perfect. Seriously, though, that's it. Let's go live to those jackdaws. We want to see if they're still alive. And they are. They're doing well. I've got, you know, high hopes for these birds fledging successfully now. I think that the birds that are coming in have failed to kill them, which they might have done if they were small. But now they're fighting back. They've learned how to hide. And it won't be long, perhaps another week, before they fledge. And then, of course, it will be a question of whether the adults, those in occupation, can hang on to the site, or even then they still might get pushed out.
High drama with the jackdaws. Now, another bird we looked at yesterday were our beautiful nest of dippers. And we were wondering whether they were going to fledge. Let's have a look at what happened. We filmed this just this morning down at the beautiful waterfall. And there are the chicks. They're out of the nest. They have fledged. Remember, to begin with, we knew there were two. Eventually, we saw four little mows. And all four chicks are out, being busily fed by the parents. They're already doing that characteristic dipping. Here's the adult coming in. Look at that little dip, dip, just a haze of water droplets on them. Really watery birds, always by a river. Now, to begin with, oh, he's dropped it, and the parent thinks, oh, I'll have that dragonfly larva myself. Nothing goes to waste. Gotta grab it, it's tough out there. But the chicks, within just an hour, were starting to peck around themselves, looking for food. They didn't get it quite right. They were picking out old bits of leaf and twigs. But all four of them seem to dig. One of them looks a tiny bit, not quite so bright as the others, but they're all looking rather lovely, bathed in that half light. They're doing a little bit of preening. Fantastic success story.
Absolutely stunning location, isn't
Beautiful,
it?
Beautiful, isn't
I
it?
Love that water's that
absolutely gorgeous. It's absolutely lovely. Well, when you look at those animals bathed in sunlight, and us as well, it's very easy to forget the miserable spring that we had. It was so bitterly cold and it went on and on. And that, of course, will have had a profound effect on some of our wildlife. And way back in April, about 6 weeks ago, we were getting very worried. So I went down to Dorset to find out more about the spring migration.
Every year in early spring, hundreds of thousands, perhaps millions, of migrating birds streak across the sea, hit the south coast, and then carry on north, pouring into the UK. But not this year. Because here we are, in the middle of April, we should be at the peak of the migration, and it's hardly happened.
The spring migration is one of the UK's biggest natural events. Iconic summer birds like swallows, chiffchaff, and willow warblers will make a monumental journey from as far away as southern Africa to breed here. Sitting on one of the south coast's most southerly promontories, Portland Bird Observatory has been at the front line of monitoring this migration for over 50 years. And head warden Martin Cade has never experienced a spring like this one.
Yeah, it's been quite uniquely dismal this year. Everything has been set back so dramatically. One of the commonest summer migrants we get here is the willow warbler. By this date last year, we caught and ringed 1,200 of them. And this year, up until yesterday, we caught 120.
With such a cold start to spring, now, in mid-April, the trees are still bare. There's very little sign of caterpillars or other insects for arriving birds to feed on. But today, the temperatures are definitely rising, so we might be in with a chance.
Shall we go to the nest?
Let's have a go and have a look.
The observatory gardens are crisscrossed with delicate mist nets to gently catch any unsuspecting arrivals. It's like fishing for birds.
Ooh, a capture. It's a willow warbler or a chiffchaff.
What do you reckon? That's... a chiffchaff or...?
I think that is a chiffchaff.
That is a chiffchaff. Yeah. Isn't that beautiful? Shall we go and ring it?
Yeah.
Any bird caught is in very safe hands. Martin and his team have decades of experience between them. Each bird gets weighed, measured and rung as part of this long-term study on migration.
This is a bit I love best.
Right, there's that little chiffchaff again. Some of these migrants, if you get very favourable weather, they might have made tremendously long flights to have got here. You know, they might have left North Africa and almost sort of flown it in one go. Sort of
really?
Cut across the Bay of Biscay.
Right, gonna send her on her way.
Let's send her on her way.
Every 15 minutes, the nets are checked for any new arrivals. And there's a delightful surprise.
Oh, thanks, Lucy.
Thanks a lot.
It's like Christmas, isn't it? You have no idea. Thank you. What's in the bag?
This is the nice bit. We have no idea what they are.
Oh. That is minute. It's a firecrest.
Firecrest.
Look,
it's a bit of a Portland special firecrest. Whoa, look at him.
I'm just as feisty. Look at the crown.
They're a thing that the visiting bird watchers are always wanting to see.
Firecrests. I mean, it's minuscule.
No, they're joint smallest British bird with the gold crest.
Absolutely amazing.
Should we weigh it and just see
how
it's
doing? Yeah,
let's just weigh it. So 4.7 grams. These are really, really tiny birds.
4.7 grams.
It's a 20p piece, isn't it, I think?
A 20p piece is 5 grams, so that's less than a 20p piece. And it's come hundreds of miles from France.
Great to see a firecrest. But where are those willow warblers? Well, good things come to those who wait.
Willow warbler.
Oh, brilliant.
Goodness. And another chiffchaff.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, B. The willow warbler. He saved the day.
That is sad for this time of year. That's only the second willow warbler we've caught.
How many would you expect?
Oh, it's the 15th of April. I mean, it should be the commonest bird we're catching now. They go right down to southwest Africa for the winter.
Because the willow warblers, we get a lot of them at Innishere.
Yeah.
This bird could well be going up.
It could very easily be there. One of the other bird observatories in Britain is Bardsey Island, North Wales. We're a little bit beyond Innishere, but the remarkable thing is we've had several next day recoveries. So ones that we've ringed one morning at Portland, the warden on Bardsey Island has caught a ringed willow warbler and found that it's one ringed at Portland the day before. Tomorrow morning it could be singing in Innishere.
It could be
remarkable.
We could actually have a camera on his nest, hopefully, if he does well.
Right. Should we let him get on his way?
Yes.
It's a sure sign that the migration is finally underway, albeit well behind schedule. The willow warblers are not arriving in droves as expected, but hopefully they will do, just not today.
Well, so far, he's made all the right decisions, staying the other side of the channel, waiting till it warmed up. But now, he's on the move. Who knows what the future will hold? On his way.
So did willow warbler numbers pick up in Portland, Bill? Well, they carried on counting them till the end of the season, and they counted 473, which means that numbers are down 75% on last year, which is quite significant.
At Portland. But the thing about Portland is that very often, if it's good weather, the birds fly over. So what might have happened is that there was very bad weather, they only got a few, and then weather improved and they all flew in. Because look at this, here's a graph that we've been given by the BTO. The red line here shows the normal arrival. So here's is the date along the bottom. So they arrived slightly earlier, normally. This year, the blue line is their arrival. They arrive about 10 days later, but look, within a space of a few days, their abundance is the same as normal. So they did arrive, they were just later. What's odd is that then it dropped off a little bit. Don't ask me why that is. Maybe they got here and thought, not for me. I'm not sure.
So a lot of them missed Portland, Bill. Did they miss Unus here? Did they arrive here at all? Well, yes, they did. And in fact, I'm going to introduce you to our new nest today. And guess what it is? The willow warblers. Let's take a look at them live. Very well hidden nest. It's there in the raised bog. And if you can see, there are six little chicks in there that hatched last week. Look at them. I just love the hairstyle. It's like two little ears sticking out. They all look asleep, don't they?
They are sleeping, yeah.
That's quite a sweet little sight.
They've got those downy puffs on top of their head, which indicate they're quite young. And, of course, those very prominent gape flanges there, those targets for the adults to put the food into. Looking healthy, though. Looking healthy, although they are on the ground. You know, it's always risky for these things. But what about willow warblers? What's the bird really all about? Clearly, it's a warbler. It's about blue tit size. A little bit smaller and slimmer. They have a characteristic song. They're not with us all year round. They're sub-Saharan migrants. So for the winter season, they go back sub-Sahara in Africa, coming back here to breed. They are insectivores, feeding on insects, invertebrates of many kinds, and ground nesters, as we've already seen. They make a little domed nest, not unlike a wren's nest, in fact, but situated on the ground. And here you can see both adults coming in, feeding the youngsters. This one's got a damselfly there, hasn't it? Look,
it's going
to have trouble swallowing that, to be quite honest with you. The wings are going to be so dry, it needs a beer to wash that down. And look, it reaches in, pulls out the caterpillar, thinks, I'll share that out. That's democracy for you, isn't it? But look, it does eventually get it down.
But I have got a question for it. It's a lovely bird, but it looks really like a chiff-chaff. How do you tell the difference between a willow warbler and a chiff-chaff, Chris?
I do admit that initially they look very similar. In fact, for a great number of years, ornithologists thought they were the same. It was only Gilbert White, the rector who wrote The Natural History of Selborne in the 1700s that separated chiff-chaff and willow warbler as species. So let's take a look, because there are differences, but you do have to look closely. Firstly, look at the legs. Chiff-chaffs have dark legs, almost black, and they have a small eye stripe. Willow warbler, on the right of your screen, well, they have much paler pinky legs, and typically they have a much brighter eye stripe, and they are generally more washed with yellow. Well, these are visual differences, and of course you need to get very good views of them to see that. But there is one other thing I can tell you, and that's their jizz. And jizz defines the character of a bird in all of its forms, where it is, its movement, everything else. And there's one thing that chiff-chaffs do, Michaela, is that they waggle their tail from side to side. Not up and down, but from side to side. So if you're, you know, trying to spot one of these things in the trees and you see the tail going from side to side, it's a chiff-chaff.
I think for most of us, you get a quick glimpse and you haven't got a clue which one it is. But if you do manage to hear their song, then it's easier to tell them apart because their song is very, very different. So let's have a listen to the willow warbler first. This is what the willow warbler sounds like. It's a very beautiful song and it drops down the scale. It starts very strong. It goes like this. So that's a willow warbler. What does a chiff-chaff sound like? Have a listen. It's more of a metronome, more of a chiff-chaff.
Have you been practicing in your caravan all day?
you actually thought there was a live chiff-chaff.
I was sat in line thinking there was an invasion of weird warblers going on, but it wasn't. It was you in your caravan.
So the willow warbler does that... and the chiff-chaff does... But then it gets more confusing. Now, we've had a tweet from, not a tweet, it could all get really confusing, from Charlie Peverett, who taped this on his mobile phone in Firle in Sussex. Have a listen to this. Listen again. What do you think that is, Chris?
It's a willow warbler doing a chiff-chaff. It's integrating the chiff and chaff into its cadenza, that falling song that you so perfectly imitated. So what we've got here is a case of either a mixed singer or a song switcher. Now, mixed singers are typically hybrid birds that then incorporate aspects of both species' song. And occasionally, chiff-chaffs will hybridise with willow warblers. Not known in this country, but it has been known in Spain. But what typically also might happen is that where you get a superabundance of one species and few of another, then they might mix the song up. So I think that what's happening here in Surrey, was it, or Sussex?
Sussex.
In Sussex. There's been a great decline in the number of willow warblers in Sussex. So perhaps this willow warbler is impersonating a chiff-chaff to keep chiff-chaffs out of its territory, so because they are, you know, virtual competitors, so that it can have that territory to itself. That's an untested hypothesis that I've just made up.
So just when you think you've got the bird song, it all gets very confusing.
But typically, the chiff-chaff and that cadenza are an easy way of separation, it has to be said.
But the BTO, the British Trust for Ornithology, want to know if you have heard anything similar to that sort of mixture of the two. And please let us know on our website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch.
Not the only warbler that we've got here, though, with a fantastic song. Let's go live to our grasshopper warblers. Now, this nest is incredibly well hidden in a grass tussock. At the moment, the chicks have got their heads down. They've been busily fed all day long by the adults. Not a lot going on there at the moment, I have to say. But you can see how well hidden it is. The chicks at the moment are about eight... Now, they're 10 days old. So they're not going to be there for that much longer, Michaela, I've got to tell you.
Well, the grasshopper warbler has an unmistakable song. It doesn't sound like any other bird. It certainly doesn't sound like the willow warbler or the chiff-chaff. Let's have a listen. You certainly hear it before you see it there. Now, it sounds a little bit like a fishing rod being reeled in, and it's often called the reeling song. It only has two notes, but there's 26 double notes per second. And it's only the male that sings, and it's usually all over by now because they stop singing once they find a mate. But what's interesting is it's very high pitch. So the older you get, the harder it is to hear. So
no,
did you hear that?
I just knew that was coming. Yes, I did hear it. Did you?
Yes, I did. Another bird that has an unmistakable call is the barn owl, and that's more a... Oh. Now, we're very lucky here on the reserve. We have some barn owls. Where are they? Well, they're where you'd expect them to be, in the barn. But it seems like the barn is a much more active place than we'd imagined.
For the last 2 years here at Innes Here, we've followed the varied fortunes of a family of barn owls. This year, we had high hopes of filming them again, when our cameras revealed our barn owl family were still here. With a special license granted, we checked the nest, and it revealed a solitary egg had been laid. So our cameras were deployed to record the enigmatic pair's life outside the barn, witnessing the owl's various visitations and nocturnal movements. As the weeks went by, we saw an increase of the owl's activity. Had their egg possibly hatched? Our licensed team returned to discover 5 eggs. The barn won't reverberate with the sound of young barn owls, though, until mid-June.
But the barn plays host to more than just owls. As dawn rises, other birds and many mammals venture around the building. A pair of rabbits graze the grass. Usually they live in groups. But this pair of youngsters appear to be living away from the safety of a warren. Barn living could suit this pair of rabbits. It offers protection and warmth. But to try and discover more about this couple's habits, our remote camera is moved to a more rabbit-friendly height. So what more will this camera reveal about the lone rabbits of the barn?
You know what? I'm worried. I'm worried about those rabbits, because surely rabbits are a social animal. They should be in a group. I think, and it does happen, that they've been kicked out of the group. Often the dominant female will kick them out. And I think that might be a subdominant female with her youngster. And they're in great danger around there.
Are they social outcasts?
I think they're social outcasts. I think they are. And I think they haven't got lots of other rabbits to warn them of danger and so on. So I think I keep an eye on them. I'm worried.
Well, you couldn't have painted a bleaker picture of our rabbit's future, I don't think. Let's think on the up here. Although they're about 3 weeks late this year, those five barn owl eggs are probably in a good place to be, because the summer's improving now, the adults will find more food. Over the winter, they didn't. There was a much higher than normal barn owl mortality this winter. But it's not so much about the weather for these things, it's about the abundance of their food vole. So although they won't hatch in time for us to see them, I think they'll probably make it.
Well, we'll certainly be keeping an eye on our live barn cam, but let's see what's happening on our live cameras with the other birds that we've got.
Our meadow pipits. Let's go to our meadow pipits. Open habitat. The nest is very well hidden down on the ground. The youngsters have been down there and they've got their mouths open. Maybe it's still a bit warm in there, but they have been out in the sun and they've been gaping all day. Obviously, birds can't sweat, so to stay cool under heat, they have to gape and lose any heat through their mouths. Now they've closed their mouths now. They're just having a little preen, getting rid of that down. And remember, these are on the ground, so there's a good chance that they'll fledge quite early. They can fledge after just 10 or 12 days, although they won't fly for much longer than that.
Right, I'm gonna stick my neck out now. I've already done it. Let's talk about the water rail. Now, I suggested that the eggs were about to hatch. What was it, a couple of days ago?
About two weeks ago, mate.
Mm. They are about to hatch, I'm sure. Let's go live to the water rail nest. Now, we've been watching it very carefully. They haven't actually hatched, but they have crazed. They haven't pipped yet. We haven't seen a little hole in them, but there's this sort of mosaic appearing on their surface. So, once again, I think they're just about to hatch out. OK, 50p?
I'll tell you more than that.
More than 50p. Let's go now to our stonechat nest. They're very different. I think there was a little bit of movement there. Oh, there it is, yes.
Beneath the feather, look.
Beneath the feather. They're quite difficult to get. They're sort of hunkered down all the time in that nest. And we've seen the adult coming in feeding, but he and she aren't there right now.
I think because there are fewer young, they haven't sort of flattened that nest out. You know the meadow pipits?
Yes.
Because there are so many in there, they've sort of pushed it and flattened it down so we can see them more clearly, because initially they were quite well hidden. Perhaps as they grow, we might get better views of them.
Yeah. All quiet, but they look okay. Good news.
Shall we see if anything's on our marsh cam? Let's have a look. Oh, we've got a couple of swans. Always makes a pretty picture. In fact, our marsh cam always gives us such gorgeous shots. Yes. And over the last few days, we've been seeing a lot of the heron, and we featured our little heron yesterday. But it's important to remember that the heron is a superb hunter and would go for some of the other ground nesting birds that we're featuring. In fact, they face a lot of threats with predators, anything from the heron to birds of prey to mink to weasels. And in fact, some of the birds that we featured earlier on last week, the dunnocks, did get predated on by a weasel. And in fact, the weasel didn't just take one chick, it took the whole lot. But it's important to remember that that weasel has a family of its own. It has to feed its young, and that's the circle of life.
Yes, weasels. How big are they? Well, this morning, one of our cameramen was out filming something quite different and saw this, the weasel coming out rushing in. Now, what we think's happening is the weasel comes out. It's probably a path that uses every day. It notices the cameraman's there and disappears back, probably smells him, wants to traverse and go out hunting, but doesn't want to be out in the open for too long. But there it is, naughtiness in animal form. Most wonderful little creatures. See, and of course, small enough to be able to run down a mouse or a vole hole, because that's how they hunt. So they are really, really tiny little creatures.
You got a good picture there,
Sentin. Sure. Thanks for reminding me, Michaela. Half asleep today. Look at this wonderful picture.
Look at that.
Can you see that? This picture's come in from Ron Cope. Weasel in a great tick box. And yesterday we were talking about how you can protect your box from woodpeckers by putting the plate on. But unfortunately, if you've got a weasel, it ain't going to work.
There he is, look, the equaliser, balancing out predator and prey. And a lot of people think that weasels are ground predators. But in fact, studies where they've been looking at birds using nest box find that weasels are a principal predator there. They will go up the trees, I'm sure, when they hear those birds, and then empty the nest box, just as we saw them finish off of our dunnock. But of course, it's not just mammalian predators here. Just this morning, in the compost heap in the garden just behind us here, our cameramen found some grass snakes emerging. Now, the compost heap is obviously decomposing, generating heat, so it's a perfect place to be a reptile, but that's not the only reason that these snakes would have come here. It's likely that they're females and they've come here to lay their eggs. It's that time of year, and they'll lay them in a clump buried deep in the compost, up to 20 or 30 eggs in a sort of a leathery, soft shell, which will hatch out in the end of August, at the end of August. But look at this, they're in perfect condition. So glossy, so shiny. Shiny as a brand new Cadillac. Look at that. Gorgeous things. I love grass snakes. I really do. One of my favourite animals.
Ever seen them hatch out, Chris?
No, I
found
them.
That'd be my dream. You found little baby grass snakes?
Yeah, they're like little pencils. Beautiful.
Imagine that. I'd like to see that.
Beautiful.
Now, Springwatch is and always has been a celebration of UK's wildlife wherever it's found. We sent cameraman Richard Taylor-Jones out to find wildlife inspiration in a location which, on face value, could appear rather desolate.
I've never been here before, Orford Ness, the most eastern edge of Suffolk. Nature owns this place, but it wasn't always so. Here, in this isolated world, our nation once investigated the secrets of British engineering and design. And for me, that's what this landscape is all about. Design. But the design of what? Yellow Sun is a clue, a code name for bombs that were born here. Nuclear bombs. Tested, stressed, pushed and pounded, designing the end of the world. Now they've gone. The buildings fade into the land, replaced by nature and its accidental designs of evolution. The barn owl. Its wings beat silently. Special feathers make no noise, helping it hear prey, detected by a carefully convex face. Funneling sounds to accurate ears. Secrecy means surprise and success for this feathered bomb from above. And the reed beds here offer a rare glimpse of a secret sentinel of watery worlds. The Chinese water deer. They've an unusual look. Tusks for fighting, no antlers. Just long enough to be dangerous, but short enough not to get in the way. An oddly designed oriental secret, living in this very British place. Orford Ness wasn't only designing military secrets, but finding them too. Radio masts reach to the heavens, a reminder of a secret listening station of the Cold War, known as Cobra Mist. The old masts long defunct, listening now belongs to the long ears of the hares that have made the shingle here their home. And amongst them, one that dazzles, that shines against the concrete grey. The golden hare of Orford Ness. A single, showy creature that stands out from the crowd. A genetic oddity in an odd place. From the long ears of the hare to the long legs of the avocet, helping it wade the shallow pools and use its uniquely sculpted bill to sweep back and forth on the hunt for food, as does the spoonbill. A very different design to do a very similar job. So many new and different lives in a landscape that plotted to take life away. Just as nature is rising here, so the buildings of Orford Ness are falling. The passing of days and nights rasping and grasping their time away. Leaving a question for our nation. Renovate this unique landscape, an emblem of British design, or forget it. Allow continued ruination, a redesign by nature. It's a big question, facing many unusual places in our nation. An idea to explore, even if you've never been here before.
Beautiful film.
Stunning.
Beautiful film. Wonderful place, interesting animals. But let's go live to our water rails because we think that Martin might have got it right. The female, who we presume is on the nest because she's been doing most of the incubation, has been seen picking up some eggshell. Now, at the moment, she's fidgeting with nest material, I think, there, unless she's got just a little bit.
Yes,
there's a little bit there.
It's a little bit of egg.
It is a little bit of egg. And this happened just a few moments ago. We saw this eggshell on the side of the nest. Look at that. So they are hatching. Now, the thing is, Michaela, with many species like this, as soon as they hatch, they leave the nest. Instantaneously. But with water rails, we think, and they're not terribly well known, that they'll stay in that nest for up to 24 or 48 hours, which might give us a unique opportunity to see these wonderful birds.
And we've been so looking forward to it because they are very, very sweet little black fluffy chicks, aren't they?
No, we're looking forward to it because they're so shy and retiring that no nest has ever been filmed like this before, not because they're cute.
Oh. Now, let's go back to Orford Nest because a great thing that we did see was Chinese water deer. We don't often get the opportunity to show you Chinese water deer, so let's take another look at them. Now, as the name suggests, they're from China. They're not from the UK. They escaped into our countryside in the 1920s. And now, did you know, Chris, there are about 10,000 of them in our countryside.
You see, I thought there were far fewer than that.
No, there's more here now, they think, than in China. But just look, what you really notice is those canine teeth, the tusks. The males have bigger ones than the females, and it's incredible because they have a muscle that can draw those back in when they feed so they don't get in the way, and then push them back out when they use them for fighting.
Articulated fangs for fighting.
They're brilliant, aren't they?
Really
quite small,
smart.
Deer, surprisingly small, sort of knee, thigh height.
Yeah, they are. They weigh about 15 kilograms. They're one of those animals that when you see them in books and on TV like this, you imagine them being quite large. When I saw one, I thought it was a youngster. They're about the size of my poodles. They're only about that high, seriously.
They're amazing that we've got so many in the country. Now, let's have a look at another bird live, our redstarts, because there's something that I want to show you about the redstarts. Now, they're sleeping at the moment, and there are 8 chicks in there. It's a big brood. And because they're such a big brood, they're going to need a lot of feeding. And in fact, both parents have been feeding them very well. But our nest watchers have been watching, and they've noticed something. That's the female coming in. You may have noticed she didn't have much in her beak. The male comes in, you can see the male with the black head, comes in with a lot of food. And they've noticed this is typical of this redstart pair. And they think it's because that the female stays close and brings back smaller amounts. The male has time to explore, particularly while the female was sitting on the eggs. And so he has a knowledge of where the good feeding spots are. And the female obviously needs to stay close in case the weather changes and she needs to brood. And it's the female that tends to clear the nest out. And that's quite typical with songbirds. But we've been able to notice that because we've got cameras on them and we've been able to notice the difference because it's easy to tell the difference between the male and the female in redstarts.
Yeah, male's a beautiful bird. But very often, you know, I think, well, I'm guilty of this. I get preoccupied by just how beautiful an individual species is. But you've got to think there's a greater beauty in the way that they all work together. And we've been seeing that here in this woodland ecosystem. And we've been seeing just how productive it is. All of our birds bringing back beakful after beakful after beakful of insects for their young. A great mixture of species. And of course, without these, without the productivity of all the trees, supporting all the caterpillars, supporting all of those insects, we wouldn't be supporting all of our broods of birds.
One thing you notice with that, though, is sometimes they come in with so much in their mouth that you wonder how they manage to feed one caterpillar to one chick without dropping the whole lot in the beak.
I'm pleased you raised that, because I'm about to do a drawing. Would you be my easel?
Come on, then.
Come on, would you hold that? OK, I've just got a pen out. Get it stuck in my pocket. All right, now, I'll just have to talk amongst yourselves while I do this. I'll tell you what, look, this looks a bit like a rhinoceros horn, which reminds me of the time that Salvador Dali was to draw the lace maker. So he went to the Louvre in France in 1955 and he drew a rhinoceros horn because the logarithmic spiral was the same as the composition that Johannes Vermeer had used in the original. He then went to complete his painting in the zoo in Paris. There you go. You may think that was
what
a distraction.
What relevance is that?
It was a cultural interlude, thank you very much. And I talked over this. This is a bird's tongue. You see, it's anchored here and it's pointed at the front. The beak would be here, the top mandible here, and the lower mandible underneath it here. And it's flexed by this stalk here. And it's shaped with these two barbs at the back, and then the tongue itself has plenty more barbs on it. And it's using these that the bird can hold the food in its mouth. This is how the blackbird, the wagtail, whatever it is, can pick up one thing after another without dropping the first thing. Of course, when it needs to deposit them in the mouth of its chicks, it merely lowers the tongue using the stalk here, and then it's able, using the top mandible, to dislodge the food into the mouth of the chicks. On eBay, not as valuable as Salvador Dali, I don't imagine.
But you know that nest watchers have been watching them feed a lot, and sometimes they notice quite comic moments like this one. Sometimes some of the birds seem to come in with such huge things to feed the chicks with, you wonder how they're ever going to get it down. And look at this. The redstart's come in with a massive caterpillar, eventually manages to shove it in the beak of one of the chicks. That is what you call a mouthful.
That is a mouthful. But of course, it's again a measure of the productivity of the woodland here. Now, we've been watching all of the nest, and our story developers watch them round the clock. But I'm not being rude. Human error creeps in. It doesn't creep in when you've got one of these. This is a tiny computer, and it's produced by Raspberry Pi. Now, Raspberry Pi are a charitable foundation that are keen to get computers into schools. These things are very inexpensive, price of a Chinese takeaway. Andrew Robinson from Manchester University has set a nest box up out here in the woods, which is linked to a weather station and one of these computers. It's measuring the wind speed, it's measuring the temperature, and more importantly, it's measuring every time a bird comes in and out, and it knows the difference between the two. And this means that we can count the number of visits relative to the weather. Would you be my easel again?
Again.
OK. What we see here is when the temperature is relatively low, there's a peak of activity first thing in the morning. The birds must go out and feed so that they can satisfy the hunger of their chicks that have, overnight. Then throughout the day, when the temperature's low, not many insects about, not much point in foraging. In the evening, they have to forage again because those chicks have got to get through the night. Look what happens when the temperature increases a few days later. Much higher temperatures, insects will be active throughout the day, so therefore we see a levelling out of all of this and constant foraging activity throughout the course of the day. Now, of course, there are other parameters involved here, the age of the chicks, the number of the chicks, but this is a very interesting project using a very cheap computer. And what I'd like to think is that pretty soon, young ornithologists, kids in school, could have these and be measuring parameters just like Andrew is, so we can learn more and more about these birds.
We always need to learn more about what animals eat, and we know that all animals need to eat to survive, otherwise they'll starve to death. But one animal's death is often another animal's survival, as Martin's finding out in the underworld.
What a gorgeous evening. Beautiful down here in the woods. Now, I wonder if this has ever happened to you. You've gone out maybe in the evening and you found the dead body of a mouse or a bird, something like that. And in the morning it's gone and you thought, oh, it's just been picked up. But it hasn't. What's happened is it's still there, but it's been buried. Something has buried that animal in your garden. Now, what might that be? With the help of Microworld, we are going to solve that mystery tonight. We actually saw this process starting to happen back on Springwatch 2011. But here it is. This is a warbler. And you can see there are those beetles around it. That's a hefty clue. It had just died, and they're not actually feeding on it at all. It's a wood warbler. They're doing something a lot more interesting. Now, I have got one of those beetles in my hand. This is a sexton beetle, or a burying beetle. They're incredibly tough. Very, very strong. I don't know if you can see, they've got this very clubbed antennae there. Let's get a closer look at the face of this beetle, this sexton beetle. Well, there it is. You can see very obviously coloured, these orange and black, but it's a face that's interesting because they've got these huge antennae. They can smell a dead animal from up to a mile off, just a smell of putrefaction. And look at those jaws. They need those jaws, very, very strong jaws, because what they do is when they find a mouse or a dead bird, they try to bury it, and they will use the jaws to cut their way through roots, anything that's in their way, to start opening up the soil underneath the animal. They'll even, on occasion, nip off the wings or any bits sticking out so they can get it underground. Why are the burying beetles burying the animal? Well, have a look at this. We have filmed this last night in Microworld. here are the beetles. It's a dead mouse. We didn't kill it. We found the dead mouse. They're already shaving off the fur. That pile of fur, the beetles are starting to defur the body of that mouse. Now, they're fighting. What happens is that sexton beetles will fly in from all over the place. This is a tremendous prize worth fighting for, and they'll have a bit of a scrap. And what tends to happen in the end is it's a family affair. A male and a female will now work together to try to start burying the animal. And this is speeded up. This was actually filmed in our microworld lab here last night, and it's starting to go underground. Now, once they've got it underground, and they do it remarkably fast because they don't want other animals coming in and taking it away from them, once they've got it underground, the female will lay eggs on it. They also smear it with a kind of chemical that stops it putrefying. That's brand new research. And as those eggs start to develop, the male and female underground will start to feed that little developing larva. That's a very rare case of parental help in the insect world. So those are the sexton beetles. Fascinating world. Now, last year, we visited a wonderful lady. She's called Kate McCrae. And she has transformed her garden in Staffordshire. It's a nature reserve in miniature. It's her very own mini Springwatch. We've actually learnt from her. She was the one that started us off on our mammal stump. Last year, she did all sorts of wonderful things, and we couldn't resist going back up there this year to find out what she was up to.
Over the last 3 years, Kate McCrae has been filming the wildlife in her garden with ingenious homemade spy cameras. Last year, she created a mouse-sized burrow called Clay Cavern. And this year, to catch even more revealing footage of her mammals, she's revamped it.
So I've created a new space, this time with lights, and within a week, the bank voles and the wood mice were back into my new clay cavern, but now I can see them in full colour rather than just in black and white. The colour images tell me lots more and give me much more pleasure because I can see those characters much more clearly. With birds, it's very hard to recognise individuals, but with mammals, it's a little bit easier. For example, I've got some hedgehogs visiting now. And there's one individual I call Squint because he's got a slightly smaller eye. When I watch the footage back, I can see how many times he is visiting each night. Squint is incredibly greedy. The fact that he visits some nights 4 or 5 times and that on occasions has actually been feeding for 40 minutes at a time and clears the food bowl so that I'll have to go and fill it up again just in case somebody else would like some. I've been feeding the foxes in the field next to my garden for about 3 years. Rural foxes here are very, very wary, and that's why they survive. And despite my hardest efforts, I haven't yet found a den until this year. And I was really lucky to locate one of my vixen's dens and get a trail cam in there and film the cubs when they first emerged. And their colour was just coming through and their muzzles were just starting to appear. Their eyes are still blue, so they were really young, just starting to explore their local area. Oh, they're so beautiful, so gorgeous. And to be able to capture footage of them when they're so tiny in a way that I'd never have been able to capture on my wired cameras, that was really, really special this year.
Foxes, hedgehogs, mice and voles are all regular guests. But this year, there have been some new visitors. And not ones that everyone would welcome.
I was absolutely amazed at the reaction I had when people first saw my footage of rats visiting. A lot of the reaction was, well, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to get rid of them? And I was quite surprised. I was like, well, I'm not going to get rid of them. Rats have had a really bad press, what with the plague and Black Death. people just think of them as vermin carrying disease, but actually when you see them in a natural environment as they are here, clean, shiny coats, great whiskers, in a balanced ecosystem, they're no more dangerous or horrible than any other creature that's living here. They're fantastic creatures, and really we shouldn't be worried about having them in an environment like this at all. On the bird feeders, when the rats are feeding, the birds tend to sit to the side and they sort of ignore each other. The only time I've seen the rat react was when he was feeding on the feeder and a magpie appeared. And for a little while it sat on the edge, but then the rat basically chased it off. And that's the first time I've seen that. Probably magpies will be predatory towards young rats, so they would take a young rat given half the chance. I think the rats are great. They're fitting in with all the other animals. And they're almost the cleaners, you know. They come when the light fades, they come and clear up everything afterwards, all the debris left over from the birds. My interest and enthusiasm and passion for this is just constantly increasing. The more I do, the more interested I become. I will never, ever get bored of doing this. I can absolutely guarantee that.
We love Kate. She's so enthusiastic, and what she's done in her garden is fabulous. And if you see Hedgehog Cam on Springwatch next year, you'll know where the idea came from. But you know, what she does in her garden isn't that difficult. I mean, she's obviously gone big, but you can do it in your garden just by using a nest box and putting one camera in, and it'll give you such rich rewards. Do it as part of Summer of Wildlife. And in fact, remember, there are lots of ideas in our brochure, Summer of Wildlife brochure, that you can download from the internet, bbc.co.uk/springwatch.
And a big hats off to Kate for me for her attitude towards rats. That's what we want. You've got to be tolerant of all forms. Everything's got a job to do there. Let's go live to our water whales, though, because look at this. Oh. She is busy and constantly fidgeting. She's turning round and round, reaching down beneath herself. She's all fluffed herself up. Look at her wings. Have you not seen her sat in this position before?
No. I think she's something brooding, going on.
Yeah, she's brooding something. There's something going on underneath there, isn't there?
By the way, you both owe me 50p.
You've got it right.
No, I got it right.
Let's be fair. You did say that, you know, last week as well, didn't
I
you?
Did.
Or two
well,
days ago or something.
Spread your bets, mate. Oh, I...
How excited will you two be if we catch a glimpse
get
now?
A glimpse.
I know, come on. Shift
come
yourself.
Come on, just
shift
move. Yourself.
One little fidget, please.
It really will be an amazing thing, because this is something that very few people get a chance to see.
Never seen it at all. Gosh. Oh, no.
Keep your eye on the live cameras.
Oh, gosh. Well, we've got cliffhangers galore, as it were. Let's remind ourselves, we've still got the jackdaws as well. Let's go live to the jackdaws. There's a parent in there. Let's hope that they're going to be all right. The youngsters look OK for tonight. Shall we go quickly just once more back to that water rail again? I'm sorry,
come
can't
on,
go away.
Come on
live to the water rail.
No.
Oh, I have to wait till tomorrow.
Coming up tomorrow, we've got Yolo Williams live. He'll be taking a look at a fabulous red kite. And also another Springwatch first. Long-tailed tits, one of everyone's favourite birds.
Now, Springwatch will be back tomorrow at 8 o'clock. Springwatch in the afternoon with Nick Baker at 3. Springwatch Extra at 9 o'clock tonight. It's a Springwatch extravaganza. Stay tuned for Unsprung!